strike action has been picking up in the United States. In the state of California, it's been Hollywood writers, port workers, teachers, and cafeteria workers. Now the tourism industry is also set to take action. It is Tian Shan reports.
California has had its share of high-profile labor disputes recently. Thousands of scriptwriters in Hollywood have been on strike for more than a month, leading to suspended and canceled television shows and films in the U.S. Some observers expect the walkout could last for most, if not the entire summer.
Right now they're not budging, probably because they think they don't have to, I don't know. But eventually they're going to feel the effect. I believe that they're feeling the effect now because productions are shutting down. So every day they shut down, that's costing money.
Many businesses that rely on the entertainment industry are already facing hardships. And according to some estimates, the economic losses could be in the billions if the walkout over pay and other issues goes on for months. And in another critical industry, union workers at shipping ports in Los Angeles and Long Beach walked off the job last week for one day, demanding better working conditions and benefits. Although operations have returned to normal, the brief disruption is already expected to cause shipping delays at a time when the West Coast supply chains are still struggling to return to pre-COVID-19 pandemic levels. Another strike that grabbed national headlines earlier this year involved school workers in Los Angeles County, the nation's second largest school system. A three-day strike back in March by teachers, cafeteria workers, bus drivers, and other student services staff kept nearly 500,000 students out of classrooms, triggering a swift resolution to their demands. Success stories like that are prompting other unions to organize similar short-term strikes. Another vote will take place this week by a union representing hotel workers in Los Angeles and Orange counties, asking to authorize a strike by 15,000 employees to walk out at the height of the tourist season later this month if their demands aren't met. It is Tian Shan, CGTN, Los Angeles.
Joining us now to talk more is Keith Hylton. He's a professor of law at Boston University. Keith, great to have you on the program. How much of an attack is this Supreme Court ruling on the right of workers to strike?
I wouldn't regard it as a serious attack. I think the court is, this decision is largely consistent with settled law in this area. And the basic doctrine is that a union can go on strike, but it doesn't have a right to damage, to intentionally damage an employer's property. So I think that's pretty consistent with longstanding law in the U.S. I don't think that's much of a new restriction
on
the rights.
Does it not give companies more power? I mean, especially given, you know, that does it not open the floodgates for employers to just file lawsuits at any given event in any future strike? If a bunch of fast food workers walk out on McDonald's and leave behind perishable food and the food perishes, can that company then sue those who strike?
No, I think the court majority opinion is pretty clear that it's a fairly narrow holding, and that there's, the law doesn't impose a duty on the union to carry out its strike in such a way that there's no harm at all to the employer. So, for example, there are cases in which unions have left the work site in a situation where food might spoil or perish. But that's not restricted. That's permitted. There's no restriction that would prevent, it would force a union to time its strike in a manner that imposes zero cost on the employer. The law doesn't require that at all. What the court was careful to distinguish is that it's that the workers lose their protection from federal labor law in the U.S. if they deliberately act in a way that intentionally destroys or damages the employer's property.
Right.
And the court found that that's what, it, in its view, had happened in this recent Supreme Court case.
Mm. Now, in 2022, there was a 50% increase in strikes. Why is that? And what does it mean for the movement now with this ruling? You say that you don't think there's any risk to future strikes, but do you think that it will impact the movement in any way?
I don't think so. And it's a bigger question to ask, why was there an increase in strikes or increase in unionization. Maybe it has something to do with the end of COVID restrictions. Maybe it has something to do with trade restrictions in the U.S. that have led to a greater level of protection for American workers from competition from overseas workers. It could be a number of factors, but I would say that my suspicion would not be that the law is playing a big role on that matter.
Mm. How do unions compare abroad with the state of unions here in the US? I mean, strikes seem to be a significant part of the culture in working life in Europe, especially France. Is industrial action more common in some countries than others?
I assume so, though I haven't taken the time to compare the statistics internationally. We have a special regime here in the US because, most of what unions do is regulated by a federal statute, the National Labor Relations Act. And under that federal statute, we have an agency called the National Labor Relations Board that decides cases, actually decides disputes between employers and unions. And that's probably an unusual way to handle much of labor regulation. So it's almost like we have special courts in the U.S. or a special court that decides these disputes and tries to balance employer interests against union interests.
So what are the sectors where striking is most common? We mentioned a few earlier, but is that pretty much across the board? You know, are we talking writer strikes, blue collar worker strikes? Are there any examples where examples of cases where unions have actually won?
Oh, that's a good question. There are a number. I live in Massachusetts, and there have been a number of teacher strikes. In fact, it seems as if there's one almost every month, and they seem to be winning those strikes at the local level. I can't say for sure. I haven't looked, across the whole country or looked internationally, but it seems to me that just judging by the small sample that I've seen right around here, they're pretty small local strikes of public school teachers in different communities in which those strikes have been pretty successful.
All right. Keith Hylton, Professor of Law at Boston University. Thanks very much for your